Hi, everybody. Welcome back from lunch. I hope everybody had a nice relaxing break. We're now heading into our third session out of four. This talk is entitled Do-It-Yourself Advocacy, Approaches by Faculty from Stanford University School of Medicine and Harvard Medical School. I'm Dr. Peter Poulos, the founder and director of the Stanford Medicine Abilities Coalition and the co-chair of today's conference. Each of my co-presenters will introduce themselves.
Hi, my name is Zainab Dinani. I am a third year medical student here at Stanford School of Medicine and a master's in health policy student. I am also involved with medical students with disability at Stanford, as well as the founder and director of Medical Students with Disability and Chronic Illness, the National Coalition for Student Disability Groups at Medical Schools.
Hi, my name is Dorothy Tolchin. I am an instructor in physical medicine and rehabilitation part-time at Harvard Medical School, and I've been working in disability education for over 20 years now. I have the privilege of serving as the faculty advisor for the Disabilities in Medicine and Dentistry Working Group at HMS and the Student Identity Group, HMS Allies in Chronic Illness, Health Conditions, and Disabilities. Thank you to Pete and Zainab for including us in today's conversation.
And hello, my name is Logan Beyer. I am a second year at Harvard Medical School, and I am involved in both of the Harvard Disability Student Groups that you will learn about in this talk. I'm also so excited to be here with this incredible group of speakers to talk with all of you today.
The session objectives today are to identify strategies to initiate disability advocacy work in your school, to articulate the value of allyship and collaboration, and to apply the underlying principle, nothing about us without us.
Thank you so much for giving that overview of our goals, Pete. I want to, just before we get started, give an overview of two things. First, the ground rules for the space that we're going to create together, and also just a consensus on the definition of disability that we'll be using throughout this presentation. So in terms of the ground rules, I think this is really important because for many of us on this call, disability is very personal, and also because there will be hopefully an opportunity for audience interaction at the end, and we want to make sure everyone feels welcome in this space. So that being said, the first rule is to make and take space judiciously. When it comes time to ask questions, make sure that you raise your voice if you have a question, and make sure that you create space for other people to ask their questions too. The next two rules go together. The first one is to recognize that the impact of our words and actions is more important than our intention. And on the flip side of that, if someone does make a mistake or has an impact that's not quite what they intended, don't call them out, but call them in so we can all continue to learn together. Otherwise, be respectful, be curious, be engaged, and I am excited for us to continue to learn together. Next, I want to introduce the frameworks that we use to think about disability. I know this is a conference about disability, and many of us come here with a lot of expertise, so I won't speak too long about it, but I thought it was important for us to have a shared understanding of what we mean when we say that we are advocating for students with disabilities on our respective medical school campuses. There are many models of disability, but the one that we mostly ascribe to as advocates is the social model. The social model was created largely by individuals with disability and defines disability as the consequence of an environment that is not built for all members of a society to be able to function to their fullest ability. Under this model, disability is understood as a difference rather than a deficit, and the solution, so to speak, is the investment of resources into adequate supports and services. The social model promotes the autonomy of individuals with disabilities and provides a platform for them to pursue personal freedom, agency, and inclusion. I also want to mention that there are multiple kinds of disabilities. And when we talk about disability advocacy, we mean advocating for people with all of these kinds of disabilities, whether they be learning, physical, visual, hearing, mental health, or intellectual. So now that we have that shared understanding, I will pass it to Zainab to give us an overview of what we will be talking about today.
Thank you, Logan, for setting those ground rules and for that incredible definition of disability for us to keep in context for today. So just a little bit of a roadmap for today's session, starting with our introductions. We're going to have both the Stanford and Harvard groups give a little bit of background about the advocacy groups that they are working within. Then we'll proceed on to think more about the lessons that each of our groups has learned, first with Harvard sharing their lessons, and then the Stanford groups sharing their lessons. And finally, we will end with some time for questions and answers. And so jumping right in, with disability advocacy at Stanford, the first organization that I'm going to talk about is MSDCI. And so MSDCI stands for Medical Students with Disability and Chronic Illness. It was founded by three medical students here at Stanford in 2018, and our work branches out along four areas of impact: awareness, outreach, diversity, and accessibility. So beginning with awareness, we recognized, and the big start of MSDCI was to recognizing that there was a dire absence of conversation around disability at Stanford. The first approach was to start hosting events that were Ask Me Anything events hosted by medical students who had a disability or a chronic illness and were open to students sharing their questions and having a really frank conversation in order to advance just comfort with discussing disability. We've also moved on to do curricular reform to be inclusive of patients with disability and more recently accommodations education for faculty, staff, and students to better understand what it means to be truly accommodating in a medical education environment. And we also saw that the medical education pipeline itself was riddled with roadblocks for students with disabilities, and chose to address that by connecting with admissions and reaching out to prospective medical students who have disabilities or chronic illnesses and wanted support. We also connect with our faculty disability initiatives at Stanford, which you'll hear about a little bit later, to build on near peer mentorship and reciprocal support. One of our key efforts has been to reframe disability as diversity and as a valued form of diversity here at the medical school. So in doing so, we've also built a lot of allyship with other identity groups here at Stanford and combined our advocacy power and focused on intersectionality in order to move the needle forward across the board. And finally, we have really pushed forward initiatives that we believe enhance the accessibility of medical education here. This includes working with pre-clerkship faculty on integrating universal learning design concepts in teaching and developing strategic interventions to improve access to accommodations in both the classroom and on rotations. Next slide, please. And so this is an image of the trajectory of my involvement with disability advocacy as part of MSDCI here at Stanford. And the real focus here is to see that you're not alone in your work, and many others exist in this space. And one of the biggest benefits to advocacy at large, but I think even more so in the disability advocacy space, is to really take on collaborating with others who are in this space and who share your mission, and to work across groups. So looking at the way we've done that within Stanford MSDCI and beyond, we were founded in the spring of 2018 and joined SUMA, which is the Stanford University Minority Medical Alliance, a coalition of seven student identity groups in 2019, which opened for us a lot of additional support and inspiration for the kind of work that we could do as well. Then looking to connect with the larger community of individuals involved in disability advocacy in medicine, and with the goal of spreading our mission to schools and communities where disability still wasn't discussed openly, we started this conference, and it was first founded and developed in the summer of 2019, and we began planning and held our first conference back in June of 2020. And that was at least what we believe to be quite a success. And that brought us to the second conference here today. And then finally, with particularly looking at MSDCI and the fact that it is medical students with disability and chronic illness, we wanted to expand our particular outreach to trainees and focusing on what it is to be a student in the hierarchy of medicine, and decided to develop a coalition of student disability groups at medical schools that would provide us with a greater pool of resources and advocacy power and community. So in that vein, we began MSDCI National in the fall of 2019. And now we have over 8 chapters and are actively growing. And so really the point of sharing all of this is to show that at each level, there are others doing this work and that are willing to share and collaborate and offer support that in my experience has been essential to the growth of our organization and to the efficacy of our work. Thank you. And I'm gonna pass off to Pete, who's going to talk about SMAC.
Yeah, thank you, Zainab. Next slide, please. So I stepped down from being the residency associate program director in 2017 and began to think about the next phase of my career. And I noticed that diversity initiatives were popping up all over campus, but the illustration on the right sort of epitomizes my perception of these initiatives. 16 people standing in a row, and you can see these differences in race, gender, and religion, but there's not a disabled person represented. And then late 2017, our Radiology Diversity Committee launched, and this is our icon from that diversity launch. And when I saw this, I was very happy that disability was included, but then I looked at the list of members and I didn't see any member with a visible disability. And so I thought to myself, you know, you can't portray someone in a wheelchair without having true disability representation on the committee. I wanted to make sure that disability and disability identity especially was represented. And so I invited myself. As we said, nothing about us without us. And you will notice a theme in this presentation is inviting myself is a recurring theme. So in early 2018, I joined the School of Medicine Faculty Senate, and I joined their subcommittee on diversity also for the same reason, to make sure that disability was represented. Next slide. Keep going. Okay, this is a timeline here, which I can barely see. So tiny. Go to the next slide. I already talked about that stuff anyways. All right. So, you know, one of the first things that, actually, you know what? Go back. I take that back. It's hard not running the deck. Oh, you're going forward, not backwards. There you go. Okay. So, you know, I joined this faculty subcommittee on diversity, and they were we were brainstorming for a project to take on that year. And I sort of sheepishly mentioned the possibility of doing a disability project. And I was surprised that people were actually enthusiastic about it. Iris Gibbs, who's the head of the committee, was quite enthusiastic, thinking that this was the right time to do this. And but of course, as the one with the disability, I was put in charge. See minority tax. So I immediately got to work trying to understand the disability landscape. And, you know, and I have to admit that I started off with very little knowledge. I didn't really identify as being disabled, just having a disability only. So let's go to the, so one of the first things that I had to do as part of the subcommittee was start an affinity group. They wanted to have a group of people who could work on these initiatives and drive it forward. And as when I started the group, I thought that it was important to define the mission. And so if you go to the next slide, I'll tell you about the mission of SMAC. So I put combat health inequities front and center to show people that we were concentrating on our patients. and ultimately including health professionals with disabilities improves care for patients with disabilities, to promote disability as diversity, of course, to foster equal treatment and well-being, and that is for everyone, not just people with disabilities, to advocate for accessibility, resources, and service, and above and beyond that, of course, required by law, and to collaborate between people passionate about disability at Stanford. Next slide, please. So this is sort of the rest of the timeline that that I'm going to talk about. And of course, and Zainab actually touched on some of these things already, so I'm not going to go into like a whole lot of detail, but we had our launch event in 2019, which was well attended, including the dean and my department chair. An important event that happened was we were approached in the spring of 2019 by the newly formed Stanford Hospital Office of Inclusion, Diversity, and Health Equity to serve as an employee resource group, or ERG, for the clinical enterprise. They were impressed with what we had accomplished in a short amount of time and did not want to reinvent the wheel. We had to consider this carefully because we didn't want to get too big too fast or be absorbed into a group whose motives were not well known and lose sight of our mission, or worse, lose control of the group. But after meeting with them, I was satisfied that their intentions were good. And so once we became an ERG, that opened up a lot of possibilities to us in terms of additional constituents to represent. Next slide. So with that, I'll hand it back over to the Harvard team.
Thank you so much, Pete and Zainab, for sharing about all the incredible work that's happening at Stanford with your organizations. And now I will take a moment to talk about what we are doing at Harvard Medical School and the Harvard School of Dental Medicine. Before I dive in, though, I want to acknowledge that there have been disability advocates on our two schools for a long time, and they have accomplished incredible things over the last few decades. But if you're also tuning in from a school that's had a lot of individuals doing advocacy work for decades and are looking to see a model of folks who have recently created organizations to create collective action, that's kind of where we are. And so the first organization that I want to share with you guys about is called the Disabilities in Medicine and Dentistry Working Group, or the DMDWG, as we lovingly call it. And we are very new. We were founded just over a year ago in April 2020, in the early months of the pandemic, brought by a bunch of students who were scattered across the country and tuning in virtually to our meetings. And we came together as a bunch of individuals, students and faculty, who are interested in disability, to join forces around our shared belief that all physicians should graduate from medical school prepared to take care of patients with disabilities, and also our belief that more needed to be done at our own institution to make this a reality for ourselves and for our classmates. So our goal was to create a sustainable, longitudinal disability curriculum thread. And to us, that meant a thread that would outlast us once we graduated, and also one that would touch every part of our curriculum, both the preclinical and the clinical. And over the course of the last year, we've been able to make more progress than I would have believed possible at the beginning. We have 5 curricular touch points that have already been implemented. We have 3 more in development, and I'm very excited to talk with you all a little later about the strategies we use to make that happen and some of the content that we have helped get adopted at HMS. One of the other things that DMDWG has done well, in addition to curriculum work, is that it has brought together a group of students who were initially interested in medical education reform, but also began to collectively see the power in our shared identities and values and beliefs. And that has led to a lot of amazing things that we weren't anticipating at the start. And one of those, as you can see on the screen, is the Disability Symposium at Harvard Medical School, which is the first time our community has come together to specifically talk about disability amongst physicians. And on the screen on the left is an image of our poster, which is a person in a wheelchair, and the wheelchair wheel is part of a stethoscope to represent that people with disabilities fully belong in the field of medicine and are an integral part of our workforce. And so the goal of this symposium was to foster really important conversations about disability in our community. And we did this through three panels, the first of which was led by students with disabilities who shared their personal experiences of navigating medical school. The second was students who had disability-related working experiences prior to medical school, sharing how those had shaped their perspective of patient care. And the final panel was highlighting some of the disability education and curricular change that our working group had been accomplishing over the preceding months. The other exciting thing that happened as part of this symposium was that we were able to announce the launch of our second student group, which is called Hatched. So as you can read on the slide, Hatched stands for HMS Allies in Chronic Illness, Health Conditions, and Disabilities. It's quite a mouthful, thus the acronym. And I think one of the beautiful things about Hatched is that it emerged really organically from our working group. As part of our curriculum reform and our advocacy efforts, the students in DMDWG started teaching each other and our peers through the lenses of our own experiences. And students and faculty alike welcomed discussions about disability and about ableism within our coursework. And this conversation over the course of months created a welcoming environment such that it finally felt right to introduce a disability identity group on our campus. Our Dean for Student Affairs welcomed Hatched into the community of existing student affinity groups, and this provided visibility for disability as both a minority identity and a welcome part of the diversity that strengthens the medical student community on our campus. So Hatched is very new. It was founded just in January of 2021, and its focus, instead of training all physicians to be able to prepare to care for patients with disabilities, is to support students with disability-related identities and their allies while in medical school. So Hatched has two main goals. The first is to increase visibility and representation for people with disabilities, chronic illnesses, and health conditions. And the other goal is to establish mentorship opportunities so students with disability-related identities can be paired with physicians already practicing who share their identities and can help them and imagine the long haul of this experience and the impact that they can have. Both of these goals are already underway, and we are excited to see how Hatched will continue to reshape the culture at Harvard Medical School and Harvard School of Dental Medicine. So now that you have this introduction to the two student and faculty advocacy groups making waves on our campus right now, I am excited to pass it over to Dr. Dorothy Tolchin to talk more about the key takeaways from our advocacy as a way to start the second half of this talk, in which both Harvard and Stanford will give an overview of some of the key points they've learned along the way in this journey.
Thank you so much, Logan, for that excellent overview of our work. So now going forward, first, Logan and I, and then Pete and Zainab will highlight three of the lessons we've each learned through our disability advocacy work that can hopefully empower you in the audience to jump in and expand disability work where you are. I want to note, too, the four of us work in large, well-resourced schools with robust pre-existing infrastructure for diversity, education, and recruiting initiatives. Still, we saw room for disability advocacy, and our efforts began in somewhat different realms. Pete and Zainab really focusing in on diversity, and Logan and I with medical student education, although we've all touched on all parts of disability advocacy, as you've heard and will continue to hear. And I point out too, and Logan has said this as well, and I want to echo, that while our efforts are all unique, we are not the only people at either of our institutions doing disability work. We all have the privilege of a network of colleagues working with us or alongside us in a variety of forms. So in the audience, your institutions may be more or less like our large academic centers. Your advocacy may start in similar or in different ways. You may or may not have disability work already happening at your institution. Still, we hope that you will find a kernel of inspiration or a new direction from our work. Let's get to that. Key forces for meaningful change. So over the past year, conversations around disability have increased both inside and outside of the classroom at HMS. Logan and I reflected on why this change is so meaningful and what key forces have been in supporting this change. To us, meaningful means conversations that resonate throughout our community with students, faculty, and staff alike. Meaningful means faculty now warmly inviting disability into the curriculum without our having to open the conversation ourselves. Meaningful means too, as we are seeing, disability being integrated into the fabric of our community as another accepted identity that is routinely experienced among our ranks. The three forces here that we will talk about are hiring of a disability services provider, the creation of a disability curriculum thread, and the embracing of intersectionality through partnerships. So first, hiring a disability services provider. So the goal of having a disability services provider is to provide individualized services and supports for students with disabilities as they navigate their preclinical and clinical work and plan for their next phases of training. Our Office of Disability Services was inaugurated in 2018 with Tim Rogers as director. We know that his hiring was the result of an incredible amount of student advocacy that predated the advocacy work that we're describing today. However, the reason we list the Office of Disability Services today as a key force for meaningful change is that Tim Rogers and his office have provided invaluable support for our disability advocacy initiatives. From the first time prospective students see our medical school's website, they see the Office of Disability Services, and the very existence of this office represents our institution's commitment to inclusion and provides a welcoming environment long before students and faculty have the opportunity themselves to provide such on campus. The office works with students and trains faculty in working with students, creating an affirming and welcoming environment. It is within this environment that we have been able to grow our advocacy efforts. The support of the Office of Disability Services elevates our work, and Tim's presence and advising for us helps us address the needs of our community, which he knows so well. So the lesson: having a dedicated disability services provider is valuable not only for individual students, but for the community as a whole. And for those still advocating for a disability services provider in your institution, remember to point out that the provider does not serve just a subset of the community, but truly the entire community. Next, disability curriculum thread. So as Logan described, our goal here has been to ensure that all students who graduate from our medical school have a personal approach to caring for patients with disabilities, informed by knowledge, practice, and a deep sense of disability humility. As this graphic from the World Health Organization shows, and as this audience knows better than any other, people with disabilities, both in the United States and worldwide, continue to experience disparities in access to and outcomes of healthcare. People with disabilities can be, but are often not as healthy as their counterparts without disabilities for many reasons, as are listed here. These include being twice more likely to find healthcare providers' skills and facilities inadequate, three times more likely to be denied healthcare, and being four times more likely to be treated badly in the healthcare system. So we have integrated a longitudinal disability thread into our school's core preclinical curriculum and are now moving into the clinical realm. Our content is included in courses on professionalism, basic science, clinical exam, social medicine, and ethics, and is tested on one of the first year students' main final exams. Using the principle "nothing about us without us," we include individuals with disabilities in designing and in teaching our curriculum. We also align with the core competencies for disability in healthcare education set forth by the Alliance for Disability in Healthcare Education. These core competencies were promulgated in 2019, and they are a set of stakeholder-driven guidelines for comprehensive disability education for clinician trainees across specialties, including but not limited to medical students. These are the six competency domains for which they provide specific educational key points. So the lesson that we have learned through curricular integration has been that teaching about disability and requiring students to interact with patients with disabilities as part of their training has opened the conversation about the need for advocacy and made space for students with disabilities to talk more freely about their identities on campus. As Logan described, our student identity group grew out of students' shared experience of the new curriculum. They identified disability connections among their peers as they talked through curricular content, both inside and outside the classroom. It was clear that there was a home for disability at our institution. We advocated for the student identity group in our institution, and we were warmly welcomed. Our group provides a safe space for students and, in snowball fashion, has begun engaging in further advocacy and awareness work on our campus. In just a couple of weeks, our group is helping to sponsor, along with the Disabilities in Medicine, our Disabilities in Medicine and Dentistry Working Group and our identity group, along with one of the hospitals in our system, are sponsoring a photography and narrative medicine exhibit focused solely on disability and disability in the healthcare system. And we're very excited about the awareness that this will bring to our entire community. So, lesson, classroom education can definitely seed broader advocacy work.
And in case anyone out there is interested in disability education reform on their own institutions, I want to talk briefly about what our approach has been and what has allowed us to make rapid changes so quickly and so effectively. So, to talk about our approach, as we've stated, the goal we had coming in was to develop a sustainable, longitudinal, and cohesive disability curriculum, and to have this curriculum integrated across preclinical and clinical experiences. The key aspects of our curriculum that we focused on are making sure that all students at Harvard Medical School can define disability, describe the models of disability and the types of disability, to ensure students have disability perspectives on public health, equity, justice, and ethics, and especially to ensure students gain a clinical toolbox to help care for patients with disabilities, including the communication skills, physical exam skills, and clinical reasoning strategies that will allow them to provide the highest quality of care for their future patients with and without disabilities. We've also tried to create a curriculum that is intentionally anti-ableist, that allows every student to understand the impact of ableism in our healthcare system and in broader society, and to understand that it is our role as physicians to combat this. So the approach that we have taken to making this very large goal happen is to work students and faculty to collaborate and to try to make change as we could. So our process started by reviewing the entirety of the existing HMS curriculum. We then identified points where it might be possible to make change. We collaborated with individual course faculty, and with their help and support, we're able to weave disability content into existing courses throughout the curriculum in a way that was longitudinal, such that each new piece of content built on the one incorporated into the course before it. Taking this approach, we have begun to implement disability education into the preclinical and early clinical coursework at Harvard Medical School and Harvard School of Dental Medicine. This includes an introduction to disability in the very first week of medical school, in the basic science courses, in our social medicine and ethics courses, and in our early clinical skills training for first years before they begin to care for patients in the hospitals, to name just a few. We have a couple examples on the next slide of some of the content that we're really excited about to give you just a taste of what we've been up to. So this is done through images, and on the left you can see three overlapping circles, one that says Hmong, one that says medicine, and one that says disability, arranged in a Venn diagram. And this image is to provide a launching point for us to discuss the way disability was incorporated into the Introduction to the Profession course at Harvard Medical School, which is a fancy name that just means the class people take during their first week of school to help them think through, what does being a doctor mean and why are you here? And in this first week of school, we've helped to advocate for and get implemented three things. First, every student is asked to take the implicit associations test for disability. Second, all students receive direct teaching on disability, including the definition, the types of disability, and disability culture. And lastly, so a subsection of students selected at random gets to engage directly with disability community organizations through partnerships with the community, going out and visiting those organizations this year virtually and in the future, hopefully in person. And the strategy here was to piggyback on our existing curriculum. The implicit associations test was already required for some identity aspects, and we advocated to include disability. Community organization visits were happening, and we made sure disability was part of those visits. And the direct teaching on disability culture capitalized on the fact that Harvard uses the book, The Spirit Catches You and You Fall Down, for its summer reading. Students were already learning about disability. We just weren't discussing it directly in our classes. And we made sure that content became part of what all students were directly asked to think about as they started their journeys into medicine. The next image that will pop up on the screen is, if you can see it, an example of a standard clinical encounter room with a bed, a sink, a chair, and a person using a mobility device preparing to come into their visit. This image is representative of the functional history taking course or session that we implemented as part of the early clinical work that all HMS and HSDM students receive during their first year of medical school. The goal of this session is to work on communication skills, specifically making sure students have the ability to ask the questions necessary to understand the functional status of their patients and the needs that patients have in order to navigate freely in their environment and complete their activities of daily living as independently as possible. This includes direct teaching on what it means to overattend and to underattend to disability. And perhaps most importantly, it also includes interviews with community members with disabilities. Amazingly, the advocates who were pushing for this session were able to arrange it so that all Harvard students are put into pairs, and each pair has the ability to interview a community member with a disability who is so, and these community members, we worked with them and they were so excited to be able to share their stories with students who so often don't get this perspective. This session also concluded with an assessment at the end of students' key takeaways. And the strategy that we used here was, one, the idea that clinical skills matter. And when we're integrating disability content, we have to make sure we hit the clinical piece too. And second, when we're doing this, partnerships are key. And we'll talk about this again. I'm giving a quick sneak preview, but we could not have done this work without enthusiastic support from the faculty already running this course.
Thank you, Logan. So I will move quickly through our third force that we are going to discuss, which is intersectionality and partnerships. So our goal in thinking in this space is to create sustainable curriculum and culture change through connections with our colleagues. Identifying areas of intersectionality and joining in work around other identities has really allowed us to bring a disability perspective into more conversations while helping our community to recognize the multiple identities that people with disabilities might hold. We help to advocate for non-disability causes, and we empower non-disability experts to incorporate disability content into their advocacy. This helps ensure the longevity of our work. We have worked with core teaching faculty and student faculty working groups, bringing a disability lens and resources. And we have invited community organizations into our advocacy and teaching work as well. So lesson learned, even though our focus is on disability, we, and also you, can achieve a lot of disability advocacy by learning about and joining into non-disability focused work. I will give two quick examples of how we have been aligning with our partners. So there are multiple curricular threads throughout our medical school's curriculum. And in recent months, we've been invited by some of the existing threads to work at the intersection of their topic area and of ours, disability. And it has been exciting now to be invited rather than inviting ourselves. So just a couple of examples of the kind of work that we are doing. So on the left, it says trauma-informed care working group. So with the trauma-informed care working group, our intersection is around trauma that people with disabilities repeatedly experience in the healthcare system and how that impacts care. So we're focusing on the language that we use, how we interact with caregivers, and how we perform a physical exam. We're planning to create a shared educational module for both students and faculty on this topic. On the right, sexual and gender minority working group. With this group, we're developing a teaching module on taking an inclusive sexual history, and within this, giving explicit attention to disability-related considerations. Now, looking at the time, I will hand over to Pete and Zainab to share their lessons learned as well. Thank you so much again.
Thank you, Dorothy and Logan, for an incredible number of insights on Harvard's process. I myself learned so much from hearing that, and I hope many of us in the audience did too. So looking at Stanford's lessons, we also categorized three primary focuses that helped drive our work forward. And so for us, the key forces for meaningful change were redefining disability as diversity, integrating across medical infrastructures, and expanding impact through strategic partnerships. So in the interest of time, we'll go ahead and dive right into disability as diversity. So our focus as we began as groups, both for SMAC and MSDCI, was to start with a position of disability is a part of diversity. And we planted ourselves into the diversity organizations at Stanford. And so we worked alongside several diversity focused entities. And as you can see with the diagram on the right, you can see that SMAC and MSDCI integrated itself into six different diversity subcommittees and departments, allowing us to not only gain incredible allies and support, but it also served to very importantly normalize the inclusion of disability as an integral aspect of diversity.
So the first thing I did when I started SMAC was to learn my ABCs. So understanding the disability landscape, sort of alphabet soup of acronyms that exist everywhere, including things like the OFDD and the SDI and the OAE and the DAO. And I didn't know the difference between any of these. And I'm sure that you guys have these offices at your school with probably slightly different acronyms. It was important to connect with these groups and learn what they were doing so as not to duplicate efforts. And when we started our group, we also wanted to keep in mind to be inclusive. So to be inclusive in terms of departments that people are in, institutions represented, disabilities represented, and of course, to allies. This is really a work in progress because silos are ubiquitous in large organizations. And it seems like I'm always learning about a new group or person operating in our space. And I say to myself, like, how did we not know about you? Well, we strive also to take an intersectional support approach, which not only advances anti-ableism, but is mutually beneficial. And being a part of the DEI network opens up a lot of resources, including experiential, personal, and financial, which are critical to our growth. Next slide. So alongside these diversity efforts, we recognized that disability representation needed to permeate all of Stanford's institutional bodies in order to create lasting change and root out the structures and policies that perpetuated exclusion. And you know, each institution has its own peculiarities in terms of structure. In our sphere, there's Stanford University, which is the main campus, as we say. The School of Medicine is part of Stanford University. Stanford Healthcare, which is the name of our hospital and clinical enterprise, is actually a separate business entity with separate leadership, as you saw this morning. You know, the dean is in charge of the medical school, but the CEOs are in charge of their hospitals. And there are other organizations and and efforts that span between entities. And so as you can see here, we integrated ourselves into basically all of these entities. For example, on Stanford Hospital, one thing we did was created a patient family advisory council. So this pairs up patients, families, and caregivers with physicians and other non-physician staff to give direct voice to our patients. That's an effort that involves multiple people from the hospital and also from the School of Medicine. An example of something that spans both institutions also is an intersectional book club that we started with the Lane Medical Library, where we plan on partnering with different ERGs to examine intersections, for example, between being BIPOC and having a disability. Zainab.
So looking at the School of Medicine, we also found ways to integrate ourselves within different areas of what the School of Medicine focuses on. And so at the top, you'll see the REMC, which stands for the Respectful Environment and Mistreatment Committee. And as of this August, we included a mistreatment coach that specifically is trained and focused on discussing issues of ableism when they come up with faculty, either in the classroom or in clinics. We also integrated ourselves within the Social Justice Health Equity Curriculum Working Group, which has been a new initiative that you guys heard about a little bit this morning. And part of that is looking at the curriculum as a whole, and we've made sure that we have disability representation. Both a member of MSDCI is on that committee, as well as through our allyship with SUMA, the Minority Medical Alliance, we're ensuring that abilities related issues are covered and thought about throughout every step of the process. And then going to those acronyms that Pete referred to, the OAE is our Office of Accessible Education. And you'll see it's listed both for the School of Medicine and Stanford University because we have one office that covers both. And one of the challenges that we've been navigating and really helping with is expanding the understanding of the accessibility office in what it really means for medical education specifically to be accessible. And with the number of roles that medical students particularly take on both in the classroom and outside of it, what the different types of accommodations are that are necessary. And looking towards not only medical students, but also graduate students, the GDCI is for graduate student advocacy around disability and chronic illness. Next slide. And so our final approach was also focused on amplifying our work outside of Stanford, gaining traction and expanding through strategic partnerships. And so as we progressed at Stanford, we really saw the importance of continuing to move beyond our own community and learning what others were doing and seeing how and where we could join forces to, like I said, amplify the impact of our work. So this was really one of the reasons for developing the conference. And so on the left of this slide, you'll see the banner for this year's conference, because we saw the value of bringing together different stakeholders and thought leaders in this field to gain a deeper understanding of how disability experiences play out in the medical field specifically, and to level up the medical community's awareness of disability-related dynamics. And then on the student level, we launched MSDCI, which is the National Coalition for Student Disability Groups, which has allowed us as, particularly as trainees, to learn from each other as well as reach out to other medical schools and work with them to build disability student groups at their institutions. And in the time that I've been working on this, I've seen not only how much need and interest there is with more and more schools realizing the importance of having disability identity groups, but also the impact that having a student-centered voice at individual institutions has made in bringing advocacy forward and in bringing progress to schools in understanding the disability experience and better accommodating and supporting students with disabilities. And off to Pete.
So we started an internal mentorship program pairing up Stanford students with faculty. But in addition to that, we also recognize the need that's out there across the country for mentorship. And so to this end, MSDCI partnered with the Stanford Teaching and Mentoring Academy and the Society for Physicians with Disabilities, which is a group run by Dr. Joe Kim, to start a national mentorship program. And we've only piloted this with a few small events involving only a couple of schools, but people so far have been very grateful to have the community and space to discuss these topics. And we plan on expanding this once we feel like we have the right formula. And I would also add that, and it's not on this slide, but another huge effort in amplifying our work is partnering with Lisa Meeks and the University of Michigan and the University of Colorado for co-hosting the Docs with Disabilities podcast. So this started as a limited 6-part series, but we've been having so much fun with it that we decided to merge forces permanently, and actually just got a grant from the radiology department to fund basically what will fund 2 years of podcast production. So we're very excited about that. Next slide. So in rooting our mission within diversity efforts and integrating across Stanford entities, and then expanding beyond Stanford, we were able to also approach this work from several areas of impact, as you can see in the boxes here. These are what I call my buckets. And we have research, advocacy, community, education/curriculum, and health equity as major buckets or categories of things that we are working on. And so our strategy has been to look at these different arenas around campus where disability makes sense to integrate, and then try and get a foothold in those different areas. And then to not only have a seat at the table, but to show progress, and also to eventually enhance funding opportunities. So for example, in the research realm, we had the opportunity to work with Lisa Meeks in Michigan and their Pathways research project, looking at the performance and trajectory of students with disabilities, and Mike Kim from Minnesota. And we gladly agreed to become a member of their multi-institutional project. And by doing so, we'll be included as authors on this study. And so we're learning and getting publications at the same time. In the health equity arena, when I heard that there was an ambulatory transformation task force formed to make sure that our outpatient clinics and telemedicine are more equitable, I emailed them to ask if disability was being represented, and it was not, and they invited me to sit on that task force, which I have. Next slide. So when considering formal strategic planning, something you should think about is whether to do it first when you're first starting out or to do it later. When you do strategic planning first, you may not have the right information or the right people in place. But if you don't do it first, you have the potential to flounder and make suboptimal decisions that are less informed and actually slow down your growth. And so while we did start strategically, we did not do a formal strategic planning process until just recently at a series of retreats that we're having and that are ongoing. And we do feel at this point now, 2 years after starting, that we do need to have a formal growth plan and a roadmap to get to the next level of organizational excellence. So I would like to give you some strategies for your own toolkit. Number one, educate yourself on the issues. You're expected to be the expert. Number two, build relationships and start a group. Share your story and be generous with it. Start with who you know. You can even start without that many members. Invite yourself to the table. Look around. Who has the resources? Volunteer for committees. Don't wait for an invitation. Have a launch party. Ask for money. This is a litmus test to see if your organization is actually behind you, whether or not they'll fund a launch party. And lastly, explore community needs. Look around, conduct a survey. What is the prevalence of disability? What is the experience of people with disabilities? You can use this survey to identify problems and demonstrate the necessity of interventions. So, next slide. Just ask yourself what you want to accomplish. It doesn't have to be world-changing. It can be as simple as creating a community. Think intentionally about who you want to include and be as inclusive as possible. And definitely include patient advocacy in your efforts. That's very important. And on the next slide, I have a few essential titles that I would recommend that you read, including Disability Visibility by Alice Wong, Equal Access for Students with Disabilities by Lisa Meeks, Neera Jain, and Elisa Laird, A Disability History of the United States by Kim Nielsen, the famous AAMC report by Meeks and Jain, and Disability as Diversity. And with that, we're going to wrap it up and take some questions from the audience, unfortunately, which we kind of went over time and we don't have that much time for it at this point. But let's, should we go to the, I think we can unshare the screen at this point. Okay, so thanks everybody. I do have some questions from the audience. Question to Zainab regarding pushback. Have you received any and what was that like?
So just to clarify, is this pushback in like doing student advocacy work around disability?
I presume so.
So I would say yes, there is some pushback. I think by and large, there's more support than pushback, and I will say that. And I'll also give a little bit of context. When I came to Stanford in 2018 as a medical student, I had no intention of disclosing my status of being somebody with a chronic illness. And it was seeing the MSDCI community that brought me to their first meeting, still nervous and worried that people would make assumptions about me, but seeing the work being done brings a lot of community. And while I will say there is some, I wouldn't say there's pushback per se, but I think the minority tax, which Pete mentioned, is very real. There's a lot of weight that's put on being an advocacy leader. Like he said, you're also expected to be the expert, and sometimes what I believe should be a consulting role is taken on as like expert and workforce, which can be a little bit overwhelming. And I will say it is difficult at times to feel like you are representing the entirety of the disability group, which I think advocacy organizers for any minority or identity group experience this. But I will say, by and large, I have found that I receive far more support than I do pushback, and it makes it very worthwhile.
Logan, what are the difficulties in achieving continuity of these student-led initiatives, and how are you addressing those challenges?
I think this is a great question, because I think anytime you're doing med ed or curriculum reform, there is a risk that things are very piecemeal and that folks get the same content over and over again. And one of the things I think that the DMDWG has done really well is that we meet every 2 weeks to review what everyone is working on, to make sure it's cohesive, and to map out our plan going forward. And these meetings have helped us to all have an understanding of what's going into the curriculum at what time point, and to make sure that things are building off of one another. I also think that as time goes on and as we have more content, it's going to be a process of continual review and continuing to evaluate ourselves and to incorporate student feedback so that it can be better and better, because nothing is perfect the first round. And so you go in with humility and you keep improving every time.
Dorothy, are there ways for schools where this work is happening to help launch the conversation? Do you have any advice to launching this type of conversation at schools where it isn't yet happening? And how do you know if a school is ready or ripe to begin this work?
Those are great questions. Well, I can tell you from our experience, we went and asked, and that's how we knew where in the curriculum there was room and enthusiasm for us. So we went and humbly talked with course directors and faculty and asked if we could have an open conversation about some of the content that our students described learning and some places where we thought, oh, there might be room for a disability voice. We came in our back pocket with some ideas for curricular interventions, but we didn't put these up front. We let the conversation flow. And when questions were asked and advice was asked for us, that's when we shared it. So the best way to know when our institutions are ready is to ask.
Thank you for that. And this question can be for any of you. At institutions with less accepting cultures, how do medical students with invisible disabilities successfully identify other students with similar interests in establishing structural change?
So I can speak to this a little bit, and I can speak to this with my hat on from MSDCI National. And one of the things that we talk about a lot is that people have different levels of disclosure comfort, and it's definitely understanding for those who are at schools with less accepting cultures to be hesitant to disclose. And not to play off of the cliche, but I think it's totally acceptable to use the whole asking for a friend insinuation and reach out and say, you know, somebody from another medical school that I know asked me to pass this along to my school to ask if anybody here is interested in disability advocacy. And the responses you get can be passed on, but they can also be used to help you see whether or not you feel like you can find a community where you would feel safe disclosing.
I think that's a great strategy. And I want to highlight the work of some students at HMS who have been doing a lot to try to make it an environment where people are able to either disclose or to anonymously share their story and reach out and create support. And they've been doing that through the arts, through a project called Unconditional Publishing. And I think that they, through disclosing their own stories and giving a platform to talk to students who would like to speak with others who might have similar experiences or who want to share that perspective, have opened up conversations on our campus that weren't happening otherwise. And so sometimes vulnerability and sharing your own story and creating space for others is another really powerful way to find out who's there with you, if that's something that you're comfortable with.
Have any of the panelists had any impact on your respective schools' admissions policies in regards to applicants with disabilities? I can take this one. So Iris Gibbs is the Dean of Admissions of Stanford Medical School, and it was actually her idea partly to start SMAC. And she has, through working with us, I think developed increased awareness of disability issues and has increased messaging, positive messaging to students with disabilities, has purposely thought about disability recruitment in their recruitment efforts. And I think, is very open to people with disabilities applying to the school. So, that's a hard one. So it's nice to have someone who on admissions who gets it. And I would say that making inroads with your admissions departments would be a very high yield approach if you want to increase the representation of disability at your school. So unfortunately, that'll be the last question. We're already 5 minutes over time. It's 1:55 p.m. And our next session starts at 2 o'clock. And let's go into our 5-minute break now.